the command center. He is fine. Everything is in control there. The White House and all the other buildings downtown have been evacuated. And right now, we do not have any word on any casualties locally as a result of all of these incidents, but we will keep you posted as more becomes available.
Yeah, Greta,
back to you.
Greta, we just got off the phone with an Air Force spokesperson. He says he has no idea if anyone was killed inside of the Pentagon. Of course, we will be trying to effort that information.
I also want to add, too, we did get a request, and I don't know if you mentioned this or not, that D.C., Prince George's, and Alexandria are all asking their fire department personnel and their EMS. Everyone needs to report to work today, immediately, regardless of their schedules. They're going to need every man and woman possible today.
And Greta, I think it's safe to say that even though no state of emergency has been declared, we are in a state of crisis. And if you are out there listening and you are a nurse, you are a doctor, you are a member of an EMS squad, a firefighter, or a police officer, it stands to reason, logic. Phone your commander, your base, and simply report in for duty. We still don't know whether or not we have seen the worst. Like the rest of the nation, we here in Washington are bracing ourselves. We are hoping, we are praying that we have. But we are going to return right now to ABC News, where they continue to cover not only the events here in Washington, but also the events that are unfolding around the nation, because we are fearing now that this may have escalated even further. We join ABC and Peter Jennings right now.
Certainly have focused on bin Laden as the bete noire and as the architect of terrorism against U.S. officials, U.S. citizens. But in this case, resources and the coordination and the direction to do these kinds of events requires capabilities beyond any one single group. In other words, there had to be cooperation, possibly with some state support, to do this kind of thing.
Okay. I mean,
we've been hearing for the last 2 months that bin Laden was getting ready to do something, but I don't think anyone was looking here as the object of his next event.
Okay, Vince, I much appreciate it, and I hope you go work the beat for us and you check back with us through the day. I'm, by the way, this is not for an immediate discussion, but I'm sitting next to John Miller of ABC News, who you've heard often this morning, is one of the only reporters in the world to have gone to see Osama bin Laden in Afghanistan. And as the day goes on, we'll clearly deal with this in even greater depth, John, than at the moment. But what we are now dealing with is a devastating human tragedy as the result of terrorism in New York City and in Washington, D.C. And just before I talk to John Cox, well, I'm more than happy to listen to these people on the street if we can possibly hear from them. But just in case, by some remote possibility, at 8 o'clock Pacific time, along the West Coast, you've just turned on your television or you're continuing to watch it, let me just review for you where we think we are at the moment. Because it is both a tragedy that has revealed itself before the eyes of millions of people in the country watching on television, and a complete mystery as to how, as we heard from Vince Canestraro just a moment ago, how this could have happened in such a coordinated way without any of the intelligence service of the United States having much a clue about it. So just before 9 o'clock this morning, just at about 8:50, an aircraft, which we now believe had been hijacked and flew into a building, hit a building. And then shortly after that, that was at 9 o'clock, or just after it, showed up on the wire services about 9:04. We could see it happen live on television as a second aircraft hit the other tower of the Twin Trade Towers in New York City. Thousands of people had just arrived at work. As time passed, we understood that these aircraft had been, we believed, hijacked in both instances. Perhaps certainly one, an American Airlines aircraft, which is destined for Los Angeles, had been hijacked and flown. Pilot either forced to fly, very hard to believe, and of course we'll never know unless they find the black boxes from these aircraft, or somebody on board that aircraft killed or got rid of the pilot and went to the controls and flew the plane into the building themselves. And then as much of the country began to connect and try to grapple with this, then we had this horrifying circumstances. At first one of the towers, this is the second aircraft flying in, then first one of the towers and two, and then the other tower collapsing on itself with at the very least hundreds and probably thousands of people who did not manage to get out of the building after the two initial collisions. And the country, the political and military establishment of the country just began to lock down very quickly. First of all, there was concern at the White House because outside the west side of the White House, behind the executive office building, we then began to see that there was fire, and that was what appears now to have been an attack on the Pentagon just shortly thereafter. This was this other tower of the Pentagon, the first tower of the Pentagon, which began to fall down upon itself. The World Trade Centers, of course, is what I mean. Thank you. Just stay out of my ear for a second. I'm trying to bring people up to date on the order of which things happened. So we then had New York City's airspace all around locked down. The airports closed down at LaGuardia and Newark and John F. Kennedy. Nobody was allowed to take off. And then shortly after that, the Federal Aviation Administration became involved and told aircraft nowhere in the country to take off. And then all aircraft flying anywhere in the country, because there was so much concern, and there is still some, that there is an aircraft somewhere out in the country which has been unaccounted for. All aircraft in the country were ordered to land immediately at the nearest airport. And then, of course, the second devastating thing at the trade towers themselves, when the second trade tower collapsed on itself. The president was in Florida, and the president down in Florida today to talk about education came very quickly to the cameras, clearly as shocked as any of us in the rest of the country. He talked to the FBI and others. He immediately canceled his education trip to Washington today. Sorry, to Florida today, and said he was going to come back to Washington, which is exactly what the country expects of him. And he said very briefly on camera that this terrorism against the United States will not stand. As we've said before, the kind of thing he had to say. And John Cochran went to Florida with him. And John, I think you're still in Florida, and the president came home. Is that my understanding?
That's right. We're grounded like all other Americans. The airport here is closed to us. The president is on his way back, but we don't know where he's going to land. You know, normally, Peter, the president would land at Andrews Air Force Base, Maryland, a military base, a secure base, just outside of Washington, D.C. However, network camera crews have been barred from going to Andrews Air Force Base. The apparently has been roped off and barred to news media. We do not know if the president is going there, and the White House is being very close-mouthed about it. And you can understand why they would want to create the question in some people's minds as to where the president will land. We've been told that when the president returns, he will have a National Security Council meeting. But where will that happen? Will it be in Washington? I can't help but think back to November 22, 1963, the assassination of John Kennedy. At that time, the Secret Service was in a great hurry to get the new president, Lyndon Johnson, back to Washington, D.C., a safe place. It's no longer clear today that Washington, D.C. is such a safe place, Peter.
Thank you very much, John. Please stay in touch and let us know when you can make your way to Washington. The uncertainty in Washington has led authorities to ask the political leadership in the Congress, we know at least in the Senate, to go to a safe location. Earlier reports about a bomb outside the State Department, we believe, are now not correct. But there was this attack on the Pentagon, and there's this mixture in Washington of deep, profound tension and almost and alertness. You certainly get a quick glimpse there of the security force, which is in constant which is a constant presence on the roof of the White House. On guard there. But there is a natural instinct, not only for the president to go to Washington, not merely for the security, because it's the nation's capital and it's where all of us in the country will look to the president for leadership and response in the hours and the days ahead. And it'll be maybe a couple of hours yet before the president gets to Washington. Meanwhile, on the ground, we have people of all persuasion, eyewitnesses, journalists on the ground who have been party to seeing this thing and are beginning to piece together for us the human dimension of how horrendous this is. And this, of course, is Times Square, in which you can imagine that people have stopped. And this happens to be the ABC News screen in Times Square, which at a time like this, as Times Square has always been for more than a century, it's always been a place where people gather to see the news. But Drew Milhon, ABC News' Drew Milhon, actually saw this happen. And I believe, Drew, you're on the phone at the moment, am I correct?
Yes, Peter, I'm here.
Would you go ahead?
Sure. I was at the corner of Varick and Canal, which is about 10 to 12 blocks north of the World Trade Center, where roughly 300 to 400 people were gathered watching the flames and the smoke from both World Trade Centers going through the air. And I began to cross the street, and I heard a collective scream from this group of people. And I looked up, and the first World Trade Center that collapsed was falling down. The shriek lasted for quite a long time, and then many of these people fell into tears, just crying and sobbing. I don't know where my mother is. I don't know where my friends are. That sort of thing was heard all around this crowd.
Okay, June, where are you at the moment? You're in the same location?
Yes, I am. I'm at Varick. I'm just north of that now. I'm at Varick and Canal.
And people are not familiar, people from outside New York are not familiar, but you're at the lower west corner of the island of Manhattan. And is that whole lower part of Manhattan being either evacuated or people just leaving it en masse?
It is being evacuated. No cars are allowed south of Canal, which is basically the last major thoroughfare that goes east to west on Manhattan. When after the first Trade Center went down, I tried to get closer to the scene, and police and FBI agents were telling everyone, both plain clothes policemen and uniformed policemen were telling everyone they had to go north of Canal. They were pushing everyone back.
Okay, thank you very much, Drew Milhon. Please check in with developments. I can tell you that the reports that we now get from a variety of places, let me just stay with the map of New York City, because the New York City Emergency Management Center is, if you're looking at that map, is just like on the tip of the building there to the north. Both those buildings have gone. And at a moment like this, they and the political establishment in the city, as well as the state and federal authorities, would coordinate operations from in there. And there are other, as you look around that, Manhattan itself, as far up as the Williamsburg Bridge and beyond, of course, is the United Nations. People have always been concerned that these two, at least two of the tunnels, the Holland Tunnel for one, the Lincoln Tunnel is not on that map, but these are the tunnels that go across the Hudson River to New Jersey and out onto the west, and that even perhaps the bridges. But elsewhere in the city, City Hall would be vulnerable as well. The United Nations, the tunnels, and of course FBI headquarters, which is about in the middle of Manhattan, not too far from the New York Stock Exchange, which you cannot see on that map at the moment. But there was nothing, John Miller's with me still, thank you very much, and I'm glad you are, nothing more patently, obviously vulnerable than the Trade Towers.
Or no larger set of symbolic targets. It's what they mean. They stand for American commerce. They stand for the American establishment. And in some way, just by their size and profile, American might. And the fact that they were an earlier target and that they withstood that, I think, made them even a more attractive target the second time around.
You can see people, and again, I'm not quite sure what we're looking at here, and I wish somebody put pictures up. Okay. This is clearly a New York fire rig, and communications are extremely, extremely difficult, as you can imagine, in a circumstance like this.
One of the things,
sometimes what you get is a picture that we're not, is either taken from a different angle or of a different thing.
One of the things they're grappling with here is, what is the crime scene? They've been talking about that today. The crime scene unit responded expecting that they'd have a massive crime scene, the World Trade Center tower, then two towers. Then the two towers collapsed, making their crime scene not only much more difficult to process, but massive. Consider the prospect of sifting for evidence, trying to find the black boxes, the in-flight recorders, evidence of other explosives there.
Let me stop for just a sec, John. We'll come back to the notion of crime. But ABC's John McCarthy is at the Pentagon. John, can you hear me? Jack, can you hear me?
Yes, I hear you, Peter.
John McCarthy, just go ahead and tell us what you know, what you've seen, how much information have you been able to put together?
Peter, this is one of those things that you dream of in your worst nightmares. It appears that a large jet aircraft, perhaps the size of a large passenger plane, came very low, clipping off light poles as it approached the Pentagon. It slammed into the side of the Pentagon, and it drove itself from the outer ring all the way to the inner ring. The area of the building that it went into burst into flames. There are many, many floors of destruction deep into the heart of the Pentagon. That area has now collapsed. The firemen have been there trying to put out the flames. There are obviously heavy casualties at the Pentagon. There have been ambulances and helicopters coming and going for the last hour. The area has been cordoned off. The skies above the Pentagon, there have been F-16s circling. The entire area has been evacuated. More than 20,000 people work in the Pentagon, Peter, and this is a disaster.
John, at ground level, for example, in the side of the building where the plane penetrated from the outer ring to the inner ring, do you know precisely what goes on in that section of the building?
I do not, Peter. That is not where the highest-ranking people are. The Secretary of Defense and most of the chiefs of the services are on a different side of the building. But in a way, it almost doesn't matter. There are going to be many high-ranking people from the Defense Department who are going to be either injured or killed in this attack.
And, John, is this something which the Pentagon is trying to take care of wholly itself? I mean, are we talking to you about a circumscribed military operation to emerge from this chaos?
It's very difficult, Peter. The FBI is here, local police are here, everyone is here trying to deal with the casualties initially and trying to make sure there isn't a second strike of any kind. That's the first inclination. That's all I can tell you at this point.
All right, let me ask you, John, because you cover intelligence and counterintelligence a lot of the time, trying to see that a second strike doesn't occur. How is the Pentagon defended in any way, and in any way similar to, for example, the Addy aircraft battery on top of the White House?
No, Peter. This Washington, D.C., because it is a democracy, has made a lot of decisions about how it is going to posture itself. And local law enforcement, FBI, and CIA have relied on intelligence as a way to defend the United States, and they're going to have to add some measures as a result of this.
And John, as you, it may be too chaotic at the moment to be talking to people about what is an intelligence failure this morning, and the intelligence services are gonna have an enormous amount to answer for, clearly, at least in the public arena. Are you picking up anything that suggests anybody has the vaguest idea of who may have done this?
They are going back over every strand of intelligence, looking for either groups in the Middle East or anywhere else in the country. They learned a painful lesson after Oklahoma City, not to jump to conclusions. They're trying not to do this. But, Peter, there are very few organizations on the planet that could put together the kind of coordinated attack that we have seen today. That points most initial fingers at Osama bin Laden's organization that has the money and the sophistication to do this.
Okay, John, thank you very much. I don't think we should be at all surprised that Osama bin Laden moves to the top of everybody's list in this. But John McCarthy makes a very interesting point, which we should talk to John Miller about this for a moment, which we should consider throughout the day. I remember sitting in this exact same chair at the time of the Oklahoma City bombing, and we all thought it was a Middle East attack. We all thought it was the Arabs attacking the United States, and that's where much of the violence is these days, but it was a sort of knee-jerk reaction, then it turned out to be one of our own.
That's right, and it was a conclusion that was jumped to by the law enforcement establishment because it fit, it seemed to fit the pattern of conduct, a massive truck bomb. The difference was it was stateside. Yet they were certainly surprised when they learned within days, actually with a car stop of Timothy McVeigh, that it was a homegrown plot. These are bellwether events. When the World Trade Center blew up in New York City in 1993, everybody sighed and said, well, we said it couldn't happen here, and it finally has. When Oklahoma City blew up, they said, we knew it could happen here, but we never thought it would be brought on by our own. This event certainly transcends either of those events by several fold. And, of course, as you pointed out, people are already jumping to speculative conclusions. But whoever is behind this put together an incredibly sophisticated program. Just the idea that you would have multiple operators in multiple cities with the ability to get onto a plane with either the weaponry or false weaponry or explosives to be able to pull off a hijacking, again, probably with a locked cockpit.
Three of them, maybe.
Again, a hijacking and another hijacking and another, and maybe one that's still aloft, that you would be able to, and this is the part that has confounded me, and you touched on this. How do you make a pilot in a plane full of passengers into a suicide pilot, a kamikaze to slam into a building? And if you do not, how do you, as the terrorist, have the level of sophistication to take over the controls of a sophisticated airliner jet plane to be able to fly accurately into targets like hitting dead center into the Pentagon, which is a low building?
You heard John McCarthy saying knocking off telephone poles, knocking down telephone poles as it came along.
Dead hits into the World Trade Center, one at the center, one near the top. As you pointed out, there's a lot of mystery to this, confounding mystery. An incredible scope.
Let's listen to this woman quickly. Well, we try to listen to this woman, not able to get her sound. Could somebody please turn up her sound if that's possible? We are looking in some cases here because of the communications difficulties, but also the communication benefits we get from our ABC affiliate here in New York City. We're getting coverage which comes from a variety of sources.
What you're seeing is West Street there, a block north of the World Trade Center. That was an emergency service police officer collapsing on the street.
Let's listen to this man. Okay. Can I just ask our director to come to us for just a second then? I think it... Mr. Goodman? Thank you very much. Let's just continue to review. There's a hard issue here for an enormous number of people. What you've seen on television this morning, those twin trade towers first being hit and then collapsing before our A's has an almost distant, we talked to both Pierre and John Brea, it has one distant quality to it because we're watching on television. We're so accustomed to violence on television. When the plane flew into one of the two towers which we saw before our eyes, you thought, well, you know, it's like the graphic artist, isn't it? So what we haven't had here yet is an appreciation of the suffering that's occurring on the streets and in those buildings.
Well, what the widening scope of the injuries, they have now notified hospitals in the outlying boroughs outside Manhattan, and they have cleared routes through the streets, covering miles for caravans of ambulances to bring the injured out as they do the triage. The lower Manhattan and central Manhattan hospitals like Bellevue quickly filled up very early on. They have now set up a system of helicopters, which they have to be very careful with because of the ban on air traffic, that everybody knows who everybody is who's flying and that there's communications between all of them to shuttle people out. The military has offered military aircraft for that kind of transport, and military surgeons have been brought to the scene. One thing unfolding right now is they've asked for gas to be shut off in that area for blocks and blocks because after the two collapses, gas mains were opened up, and there's a gas leak in the air, which only fosters the danger of yet more explosions.
Exactly. Pierre?
Well, one of the things that they've been very concerned about in recent years is the notion that could hospitals deal with massive amounts of casualties like this? And now they're going
to... Let me just interrupt you for a second so we hear it as it's happening.
Just come out, we're walking.
Just come down. The second, everyone's being asked to get down. Come down. The people are now panicking again.
Give him air, give him air. Give him air, you can walk, you can film.
Well, I've seen it's been repeated hundreds and hundreds of, as far as we know, thousands of times. The reports in John Miller was talking about the number of hospitals and the military making its its medical staff available to the citizen, to the layman hierarchy here. We've had reports from various hospitals saying that hundreds of people are burned from head to toe. One doctor at St. Vincent's Hospital in Lower Manhattan just simply said the place was crowding up very quickly by people who had been burned. And the horrifying magnitude of all this is to be reminded. I'm going to try to get this right, Nancy, but I think maybe as many as 50,000 people work in the immediate area of the Trade Center, of the World Trade Center, in which there are these two twin towers. Am I right on that? As many as 50,000 people working?
I don't know the figure, but the World Trade Center complex, not just the two towers, which are, you know, over 100 stories each, but they're flanked by the World Financial Center. So there are clearly tens of thousands of people within a two-block radius.
And John McQuethy, who called in just a short while from the Pentagon, talking about the aircraft that had penetrated the outer ring of the Pentagon to the inner ring, we're talking about the Pentagon now, had many floors of destruction and heavy casualties. It's just impossible at the moment to grasp, other than to try to aggregate the normal circumstances of how many people live and work in the immediate area. And thousands of people work in the Pentagon every day, which has now been overrun by local police and by state authorities and by the military itself trying to take care of its own. Tony Cordesman, who's one of our military analysts, is on the phone from Washington. Tony, what can you add to all this?
Yes. Peter, can you
hear me?
Yes,
Tony, I can.
I think one of the things we need to understand is we've been preparing for this kind of event for nearly a decade. We've had presidential directives. It's a project called Homeland Defense. But quite frankly, what people were most worried about was the use of weapons of mass destruction, chemical, biological, or nuclear weapons. Well, we looked at this scenario, hijacked aircraft flying into buildings back in the 60s. It wasn't the focus of Homeland Defense activity. It wasn't something brought up on the screen of the Vice President's office, which formally is in charge with coordinating this effort.
But Tony, you, I know, been party to a lot of these. Is that speaker I hear behind you?
Yes, I'm.
Could you just turn around and ask somebody to turn it down?
Hold on, please. I'm on to Peter. Could you turn it down?
Thanks very much. Sorry to interrupt them because they're all doing a job. But your involvement here is important because you've been involved in so much of planning and study of this opportunity. I don't get it. In the 1960s, yes, we looked at the possibility that people would hijack airplanes and fly into buildings. How did it get off the radar?
I think the problem, Peter, is literally we have tens of thousands of points of vulnerability. As Jack McQuethy pointed earlier, it's the Pentagon. It's symbols of our national heritage, like the National Archives. It's major utilities, nuclear power plants, targets like ABC News and the networks. The problem is that anticipating all these points of vulnerability in a democratic society in defending them is almost impossible. There's always been this area of vulnerability, and we've always put civil liberties and civil rights before trying to deal with a comprehensive defense. This may change those priorities. It certainly is something short, if not actually at the level, of an act of war.
And Tony, you have seen us this morning, or heard us this morning, go through the ritual of reciting that somebody had claimed responsibility, someone had denied responsibility, the Palestinian Authority and the person of Yasser Arafat was very quick to come along and offer condolences to the people of the United States, to put as much distance between himself, because he gets blamed for a lot in the Middle East, certainly by the Israelis. Do you have any feel for how complicated an operation this is and who might be able to mount it, or are we just blowing in the wind at the moment?
You're not blowing in the wind at all, Peter. This is so complicated an operation that one reason we weren't ready is that no one believed there was an organization with either the intention or the capability to execute something like this. People talk about Bin Laden's group, but it's an umbrella group. It is the elements under it that would have had to do it, not Bin Laden himself. We have talked about Iraq, but Iraq's operations have never been particularly sophisticated. We've talked about Iran, but while we can identify that the Iranian leadership was involved in Al-Khobar, we've never seen anything this ambitious. And groups outside the Middle East, like the Japanese Red Brigades, have never come close to this level of operation. I think it's also important to note that we talked earlier about bin Laden being Arab. Bin Laden's operations now have many elements that are not Arab. They are Islamist extremists. They involve groups from countries like Pakistan and other elements. And what we've never seen is a level of coordination among all of these different groups that would lead us to prepare.
Okay, Tony, thank you very much. Very, very grateful to have you here and to remind us all that what has been happening to us all, in terms of being witnesses today to this, and everybody now gets deeply emotional about it, the people who've been involved. And again, remind you that many thousands of people work in the Twin Trade Towers in New York City, many thousands of people at the work in the Pentagon. There have been two aircraft at least today which have gone down with passenger loads on board. And in fact, there has been a third crash in Pennsylvania, which I shall bring you up to date on in just a moment. But we've had a written statement from American Airlines this morning, and let me just read it to you, or parts of it as it come. American Airlines confirms it lost two aircraft in what it describes as tragic incidents this morning. There was Flight 11, which was a Boeing 767 en route from Boston to Los Angeles with 81 passengers, 9 flight attendants, and 2 pilots on board. That aircraft was hijacked, to the best of our knowledge, and flown into the Trade Towers in New York. And Flight 77, a Boeing 757 offering from Washington Dulles to Los Angeles with 58 passengers and 4 flight attendants and 2 pilots, that aircraft is a little more uncertain. That is not a huge, it's a big aircraft, 757, but we're not certain whether that's the one that went into the Pentagon or whether it's one of the other aircraft that went into the Twin Trade Towers. But the government has now shut down the entire air traffic system in the United States. And we learned just a while ago, for example, that all international flights heading to Canada were going to be diverted to Canada. And the Canadians have now shut down their entire air traffic system as well, a reminder of how close the two nations live together and how Canadian airports from one end of the country to the other are within an hour's flight or less in some cases of major American targets. So now let's get involved with one more crash to start with. ABC's Lisa Stark, who covers aviation, is on the phone with us from Washington, or at least I believe in our bureau. Lisa, can you hear me?
Actually, Peter, I'm in Seattle today, ironically, for an aviation conference.
Okay,
can you hear me, Peter?
I can indeed, Lisa, and tell me what you know.
Well, what I know is that the flight that went down outside Philadelphia, I believe, in Pittsburgh, was United Airlines Flight 93. It was a Boeing 757. It was en route from Newark to San Francisco. I do not know how many people were on board that plane. United is also saying now that they are concerned about a further flight that apparently is still missing, Flight 175. It is a Boeing 767. It was scheduled from Boston to Los Angeles. That flight apparently is still unaccounted for, according to officials from United. So we believe there's at least one more plane that may still be flying around, in U.S. airspace. Obviously, Peter, I've also learned that one of the planes that went into the World Trade Tower was tracked by the FAA. They knew, I don't know if they knew it was hijacked or if they just knew something was wrong. Obviously, it had deviated from its flight path. They were able to track it on radar, and they did track it to Lower Manhattan. That is the latest we know about the flight.
Lisa, this may seem an awfully dumb question, but given the fact that the airlines, the major airlines, operate in such an intensely coordinated way, at least with their own operation centers, how is United Flight 175, a 767 from Boston to Los Angeles, thought to be missing and unaccounted for?
Well, all United is saying is that they are, quote, concerned about that flight. What I believe is that that flight was hijacked as well. Where it is right now, I'm sure perhaps the FAA, the FBI, and those folks know where it is. We are not being told. But there may still be another plane flying out there that has not yet crashed or landed or whatever will happen to it. But that flight is apparently at least unaccounted for at this time as far as public release. I'm sure someone knows where that flight is.
Yeah, okay, thanks very much then. Lisa Stark in Seattle today. I thought she was in Washington, covers aviation for us. Barbara Starr, one of our principal reporters at the Pentagon, I think is on the line as well. Barbara? Barbara, do you hear me? Barbara Starr?
Yes, Peter. I'm standing outside the Pentagon. About 10 or 15 minutes ago, we saw 50 to 75 military personnel move onto the helipad. They are stretcher bearer volunteers. They have been assembled to go in and recover any potentially dead or wounded. And we have talked to an eyewitness who was down on the helipad earlier this morning, where the fire is, of course, still ongoing. He reported seeing more than a dozen wounded personnel earlier this morning. We have seen ambulances carry people off. About an hour ago, we saw emergency medical personnel bringing out a woman and a small child in their arms. So the situation here remains quite unsettled.
Can you describe a little more generally what unsettled mean? Is it calm? Is there chaos?
We have had periods of what can only be described as chaos. About 15 minutes ago, security personnel came through again and told us to start running, to move back, that there was another aircraft moving up the Potomac River from the south at a high rate of speed. Well, that apparently did not occur, and we have now moved back to our original camera position. So the police are quite at a point of quite high tension here this morning, and any little ripple is having them move people back to stay away from the building. They are extremely concerned about another attack and a potential additional explosion. They are taking every precaution.
Understandable. Barbara, the portion of the building that was breached when the aircraft crashed into it, do you know what happens in that part of the building?
Well, we're looking at it right now. Fire trucks are still pouring water more than an hour or better after the explosion onto the plane. This has occurred where the helipad is, a helicopter pad with small control tower where military helicopters, and including Air Force One helicopters, take off and land regularly. A very senior military official told us he heard an explosion on the fifth floor of the Pentagon, and he believes that that's where the impact was. But looking at the side of the building, you can see smoke and flames, and the building is singed, literally, top to bottom. Water is continuing to be poured on the flames by company.
Thank you, Barbara Starr, very much. We've just seen a helicopter flying over the center portion of the District of Columbia. Maybe we can get another glimpse at that. It's gone out of frame now. I am wondering now whether or not we are not possibly looking at the president returning to the White House. Claire Shipman, you've got a pretty decent vantage point over the White House. Is that possibly what we're looking at? Okay, Claire Shipman, we'll get to as much. She's got a very good vantage point over the White House. It does not by any means look like the traditional arrival of the president from Andrews Air Force Base in a Marine helicopter on the south lawn of the White House. And quite frankly, everybody on the roof, with a few remaining people on the roof of the building now. This is a permanent guard. I think we're all in the country familiar with the fact that this is a permanent military installation on the top of the White House, as there is one of the really intense perimeters around that. But I think they would not have been quite so relaxed if the president was returning to the White House. And you heard John Cochran report from Florida a while ago that there is nobody's told him where the president is going to land on his way back. In fact, he does traditionally land at Andrews Air Force Base, and we have no idea precisely where he is going to land. But there is no doubt at the moment that authorities are on alert from coast to coast still. All air traffic halted. All high-profile buildings in New York City, certainly in the District of Columbia, all of the national buildings have been evacuated. It's certainly been true in Chicago. The Sears Tower of Chicago was evacuated. So were the tallest skyscrapers in Boston, Cleveland, and Minneapolis, and the Space Needle as well in Seattle was closed. Military bases all across the country went on alert, on a variety of stages alert. In Washington, military personnel were put on what's called alert level Delta, which is the highest possible alert status, and military personnel throughout the country were put on Charlie threat level. For people who follow those things, we say them often without knowing what they mean, but they're both pretty high states of alert. There was extra security put in place at the Department of Energy's nuclear weapons and research complex in Oak Ridge, Tennessee. They put in extra security at the Los Alamos National Lab in New Mexico, and among the other places at Fort Detrick in Frederick, Maryland. This is to give you some sense of the magnitude. We're looking at a limited amount of picture of New York City and Washington, but just let me just go on with this list of what people did across the country today. In Louisiana, the state police urged all petrochemical and pipeline companies to be on alert. In this particular tension, a target which people who study terrorism believed which was vulnerable. In Los Angeles, all of the police in Los Angeles went on tactical alert and mobilized their anti-terrorist division. You recall before the World Trade Fair, the World Trade Meeting that was held up in Seattle, one of the last times the system really worked and everybody efficiently was when they caught a guy coming across the border from British Columbia and Canada with a view to blowing up the Space Needle, I think it was at the time, in the Space Needle in Seattle.
That's what they originally suspected, and then later updated it.
Turned it into something in Los Angeles.
When he began to cooperate, he admitted his plan was to set off a massive bomb inside the terminal of LAX, Los Angeles Airport.
That's right. And what I remember at the time about that, John, which is why everybody in the country is so on edge today, is, you know, here was a guy who was picked up by one agent at one border crossing in the country because he was sweating.
One alert agent who didn't like the fact that he was panicking.
Yeah, okay.
Under questioning.
Let me go back now to the World Trade Center. Just to finish this very quickly. Under orders from the FAA, airports nationwide are now closed all across the country. Anybody's just connecting with the world today and you're planning to go anywhere on an aircraft from one place to another, you can just forget it. So let's go back to the World Trade Center in Lower Manhattan on the west side and talk to Don Daler. Don.
For New York yet. As you know, this is one of the most densely constructed pieces of real estate in the world. And when the Twin Towers collapsed, it appears that they ignited fires on surrounding buildings. I'm seeing a huge amount of smoke. Just about 15 minutes ago, there was a phalanx of firemen, I would say probably about 50 firemen, moving deliberately into this black cloud of smoke. They disappeared completely into it. Then about 5 minutes ago, there was quite a bit of activity as a number of police officers started moving back individuals as well as firemen who were with their fire trucks away. So they moved the line of demarcation back away from that area. And I can see at least two buildings look to be partially involved just from my vantage point. I'm about four blocks away from where the Twin Towers once stood. Right before the second tower collapsed, when you and John were talking about the concerns over that possibility, Mayor Rudolph Giuliani walked right past me here on Church Street and Duane Street, again about four blocks from that area, moving his entourage out of that region. And then just moments later was when the collapse happened. There was a complete cessation of ambulances and any kind of emergency traffic in this area for about 5 minutes. And then slowly, I saw one or two ambulances trickling out of this incredible cloud of dust with debris on top of them. Some of them had broken windshields. There was a police car that came by that looked like the top had been almost completely stove in. And that's one of the most disconcerting aspects this morning has been on this avenue that has been opened up, Church Street. There's just been a trickling of emergency vehicles coming out of that scene and towards the hospitals. I'm not sure how much they've been trapped down in that area or whether they moved away and are going to some of the other area hospitals that don't come by here. But I've not seen anywhere near the number of ambulances leaving the site that one would expect.
Don, let me ask you this. Do you have, and I realize this is a tough one to ask you to speculate about, after the attack occurred on the aircraft, the first aircraft attack on one tower and then the second one, how many people managed to get out of that place before they collapsed? Have you any idea? Would you see a large number, small
number? I saw a river of people at first running when the first attack happened. There were screams. A lot of people were looking up in shock. And then about, I would say, a minute and a half later, there was a steady stream of people moving from closer to that area, running up the streets. Then, of course, as human nature, a lot of people stopped, feeling that they were maybe far enough away that it was safe, started looking up, talking, pointing, and then the second plane hit. And that, again, caused another stream of panic. As the police started to respond and started to try to clear the streets, there was a very calm, organized evacuation of the southern part of Manhattan. I saw no panic whatsoever. It was very calm. The police were directing traffic, getting all the cars out of this area, getting all the people north. But when the first tower, the one that actually was that you saw, was the second tower hit, but the first tower to collapse, fell, then it was mass chaos. And there were thousands of people running up the streets. This billowing cloud of dust and debris came washing up over here four blocks away, which only exacerbated the chaos of the moment. And then from then on, from the time that the first tower collapsed, there was just the street here, Church Street, was just full of people covered in dust, holding their handkerchiefs or their papers over their mouths to try to breathe, moving northward away from this area. That stream trickled out, and then when the second building collapsed, once again, there were more people. But this time, when the second building collapsed, I witnessed firemen who were helping one another, struggling up the street, covered in debris. There was a police officer who was being carried by two other police officers trying to get out of that area. So there was obviously a lot of collateral damage with the people around that area. I would say even not just at the base of it, but for them to have gotten to my point that quickly, they would have been injured probably two and a half blocks away from where the towers fell.
Don, thanks very much. Don't go away, because you've helped us appreciate at ground level what, as I said before, seems almost surrealistic when you look at it on television. In terms of people getting out of the trade towers, do you have any sense at all, have you heard anything even anecdotally from the cops about how many people managed to get out of the building before they collapsed?
No, absolutely not. But you can imagine that the World Trade Centers, I'm not sure how many elevators exactly they have, but I have been in those buildings, and I think there are around 20 elevators in each. If they shut down immediately, you can imagine the people who would be streaming down the fire escapes and the stairwells. There's also, I don't know if it was the case now, but I do know that one of the towers had a major elevator that went all the way to the top that was malfunctioning and has been malfunctioning for at least a month. They've been having a lot of trouble with that. Not that that would have made any kind of difference, of course. Once those elevators shut down, as soon as I imagine the fire alarms go on and that kind of thing, it's de rigueur that the elevators are not to be used in that situation. If the elevators go all the way to the top, and that's where the extent of the damage was at the very top of these, there's probably no way that anyone on the lower floors was able to use elevators. So they were all going down the stairwells, and one can only hope that there was quick enough reaction that they did get clear away, that they did not stop at the base.
Thank you, Don, very much. You know, somebody said, looking at the Pentagon this morning, that it reminded them of World War II. Clearly a person too young to remember World War II. But as you look at these scenes, you can feel absolutely clear that you're looking at the results of the United States at war with angry and vicious people who will do in the future, as they have in the past, whatever they can to get at the United States, this huge presence in the world, with any number of enemies in the world, with any number of people who feel the United States has messed up their lives or their countries or their movements or impeded them from something. And so, in fairness, without being too carried away with it, we are looking at pictures from a war zone this morning. Not a picture, something that looks like a war zone, looked like an old war zone, but it's a picture of a current war zone in this endless battle between the United States and its enemies, usually small groups of enemies. We're talking into countries to some extent here, but we're talking about the most unconventional form of warfare that man engages in, which is terrorism, designed to cause terror, designed to have an impact on the psychology of Americans, designed to show that the United States is vulnerable. What better expresses American vulnerability than to watch these two symbols of American commerce and government and pride at the lower end of Manhattan collapsing in upon themselves after having been attacked by two hijacked aircraft. That is what it looks like at the moment. Looking out, this is from the top of the ABC building, and we're like 60 blocks north, more than 60 blocks north of the trade centers. And as we look down, that's what they look like under normal circumstances. We can see them from almost anywhere in the city, and people go to the top of them on a regular basis so that they can see the huge surrounding area, including, I might add, right in their face, the Statue of Liberty on a day like today. And they are both gone. Now, just to deal with the possibility of the missing United Airlines flight, the mayor of Cleveland, Michael White, says that a Boeing 767 out of Boston has made an emergency landing at Cleveland Hopkins International Airport because of concerns that it may have a bomb aboard. There is some possibility that may be the missing United flight, but we do not know. But anybody who's in an aircraft this morning and made an emergency landing safely is probably one hugely relieved person at the moment. I want to go back to Washington. Claire Shipman is just across Lafayette Park from the White House. It's a traditional place in which we broadcast from when we're covering White House and Washington affairs. Claire, do we know where the president is at the moment?
Well, Peter, that's what we've been trying to figure out. I've been told by sources that Air Force One hasn't landed yet. What we're trying to figure out is, as you were talking about earlier, where that plane will land and where the president will go. The Secret Service have essentially told me, we have an emergency plan in place for exactly this sort of thing, and of course, we're not going to tell you where we take our protectees, including the president. And there was some question about whether he would even land, as he normally does, at Andrews Air Force Base. Now, there is a small press pool traveling with him on Air Force One. I've been told they may stick fairly close with him once he does land, so we may learn something more. But in addition, the entire staff of the White House and the old executive office building, State Department, has been scattered around town. There's no reaching anybody from the NSC, the press office. They're all trying to set up temporary offices, and at some point they may have them up and running. But right now, there's very little information about how this government is running and from where it's being run.
And of course, Claire, these are all really, truly important psychological factors in the war between the United States and those people who would harm it, because if the government is seen to be in, I don't mean to suggest disarray, but seen to be uncertain, then this is going to simply make America's enemies happier.
Oh, absolutely. This is exactly the sort of response they would like to have. And of course, this government doesn't make this sort of evacuation decision lightly. Remember what you were talking earlier about the Oklahoma City bombing. They didn't evacuate at that point. We all stayed in the White House because they didn't feel it was necessary, and they don't want to do it unless they believe it is absolutely necessary.
I have been saying, perhaps you will think too blithely, that the president is no safer than he is in the White House. Is that the conventional wisdom among the current White House press corps?
You mean
that the president wants to be in the safest place? He's in the White House, unless he's in a bunker somewhere.
Well, I think that is normally true. But again, in a situation like this, where it's obvious that they're just not sure what's going to happen, they believe there are safer places for him. The Secret Service told us absolutely they have places they believe are safer for their protectees than the White House. Remember, we talked about this earlier, but just a couple of years ago, a plane landed on the White House lawn.
Right.
So mistakes do happen in terms of the protection of the president, and they don't want to take any chances at this point.
Thanks very much, Claire. But one more question. We try to track the political leadership in the city generally, and I realize this is in large measure a serious effort, but also something of an academic exercise. Where are the leaders of the Senate and the House at the moment?
Well, we've been told that the leaders of the Senate, at least, have also been, according to a plan, taken to safe destinations, and we can't find out where. Colin Powell, we're told, is on his way back from Peru. He would also be taken to that sort of safe destination, presumably with the president.
Okay, thanks very much, Claire. People at home, I think, know by now that we get information from a variety of ways, and here's a piece of information about the president's advisors that Claire may or may not be party to, that they're preparing a list of options, including closing the nation's borders. Now, we all know, as the struggle over legal and illegal immigration and the desire that people have to come to the United States, how difficult that is. But the notion, we've now got all the airports in the country is closed down. We've got all the Canadian authorities pretty much mounting the same kind of operation there, at least temporarily, to see that nobody uses a Canadian airport in order to get an aircraft off the ground to come in this direction. Customs, U.S. Customs, has moved to something they call Threat Level 1, which is the highest state of alert that the Customs Department has. It is the Department of Treasury, of course, has. All air and marine assets are now on alert. We think covered that before in terms of the state of the military. The borders are not closed. And we are told by immigration and by customs at this point there have been no unusual incidents at any of the border crossings, either between the United States and Mexico or between the United States and Canada. And several, it seems like it's not very long ago, it's only been 3 hours, almost to the minute, since this actually happened. And early on, we made the observation that in some respects this is the most serious attack on the U.S. mainland. Since Pearl Harbor. And I notice now that at least one senator in Washington, Senator Chuck Hagel of Nebraska, referring to that attack 60 years ago, which so surprised the nation, has now called this the second Pearl Harbor. And so much, of course, is different in the world. And yet one should not be surprised if this comes to be referred to that in the days and in the weeks ahead. We've managed to put together a couple of pieces, a couple of pieces of information on tape. And one of them is, I believe, a quick comment and a quick comment only from Mayor Giuliani of New York. Can we just roll that, please?
Hold on. Put your mask on.
Mayor, what's the situation right now?
The situation is that two airplanes have attacked, apparently.
You can't go to sleep.
Why?
You should not go to sleep.
All right, well, then let's go north then.
Can you tell us basically what happened? Two airplanes?
Two. Come with us. Come with us. Well, let's talk a little later, okay?
Okay. Sorry. City Hall, okay.
You could never, ever underestimate how important the political leaders are and their respective communities are to the country at this moment. Mayor Giuliani, who's coming to the end of his term in office, down there, very characteristic fashion of him, John Miller, to go immediately to the scene. Some mayors have not, and it has cost them politically, but you see in that early picture, maybe that's an hour or so ago, in which he's just caught above as much guard as...
Yes.
Anybody else.
And he's covered with dust. He's walking with his principal bodyguards. The other man wearing the mask, who stopped him from speaking, obviously for security reasons, wanting to get him further out of the area, was his police commissioner, Bernard Carrick, who, as the mayor was about to stop and give a briefing, said, no, we have to go further out, concerned for, you know, other damage and his safety.
Okay. Senator Schumer of New York is, I believe, on the phone. Senator, are you there? And can I ask where you are?
Yeah, I am in Washington, Peter.
Good. Obviously, you, sir, have something to say, and here's
well,
the space.
Well, I just, you know, I mean, we're all just totally shocked here. I mean, probably there are millions of New Yorkers who are in my position. My wife works... I'm in Washington, but my wife works a quarter of a mile from the World Trade Center. My daughter goes to high school within the shadow of the World Trade Center.
Have you spoken to them both?
I did speak finally to my daughter. I spoke to my wife earlier this morning, and I spoke to my daughter about a half hour ago. Both were obviously extremely shaken by what's happened.
Senator, you know precisely that 50,000 people work in the World Trade Center. There are 155 businesses in there, and 80,000 people visit the World Trade Center every day. How can you give us some sense of your feeling about the magnitude of this, your knowledge of the magnitude of this?
It leaves you almost speechless. I was going through each floor, and I know people on almost every other floor, and I'm sure that's true of so many people here. This is such a dastardly act aimed at the heart of America and the heart of New York, and it is...
There?
You don't even know what to think. It is just so awful.
Senator, I apologize for
interrupting. We're going to have to
Senator,
redouble our efforts because terrorism leaves nobody.
Senator, I apologize for interrupting you. I really do. But this is an American Airlines news conference, which we do want to have. We'll come back to.
Not that I'm aware.
We've been in business here 26 years. I get. Have we ever done this? Close the airside to all the terminal buildings? This is unprecedented.
Yes, sir. We have not done it. It is this level of security has not happened before.
We hear from the aviation community that there is a rumor that military jets are escorting a commercial aircraft to this airport right now. Can either of you comment about that?
I have no earthly idea, sir.
Mr. Chairman, do you know anything about that?
I would assume that since all of the aircraft that are due into DFW have landed, there are no military escorts. Now, whether there was a military escort provided to them or not, we're unaware of that.
We can take about two more questions, and we're going to have...